Apple finally released the Pro and Max versions of the M2 chips. So in this video, I'm going to give you an in-depth review of the base 10-core M2 Pro chip from the perspective of a working audio engineer. I'll compare it to the M1 Max chip and the base M2 chip in some aspects, and discuss some pretty surprising differences in performance among Logic Pro X, Reaper, and Ableton Live as a result of different level of DAW optimization. I'll be employing testing methods that are designed to give you an idea of how the chips perform in real-life audio mixing and mastering scenario. If you have watched my review videos for the M1 Max MacBook Pro and the M2 MacBook Air, you know you're in for a fun and informative ride. The computer I bought was the base model 14-inch MacBook Pro, which has the M2 Pro chip with 10 cores, 4 of them efficiency and 6 of them performance, 16GB of RAM and 512GB of SSD storage. The chip has a 16-core GPU, but GPU doesn't really matter for music production in general, at least not for now, so that aspect is irrelevant. You can get the exact same specs in a Mac Mini, so even if you aren't interested in a laptop, this video is still for you, as long as the M2 Pro chip is what you're curious about. The M1 Max computer I will use for comparison has the M1 Max chip with 10 cores, 2 of them efficiency, 8 performance, 64GB of RAM, and 4TB of SSD storage. This has been the main computer for my studio business just for over a year. I use it for mixing large projects, teaching audio production virtually, editing complex 4K videos, and creating motion graphics. And nothing has even made it sweat yet. So I'm curious to see how the M2 Pro chip holds up against it. In some cases, I'll also bring in the base model M2 MacBook Air for comparison. It has the 8-core M2 chip, 8GB of RAM, and a 256GB SSD. In terms of hardware, the 14-inch MacBook Pro is noticeably heavier and bulkier than the M2 MacBook Air. Just by holding them, the 14-inch MacBook Pro is smaller in size, but it feels pretty much as heavy as my 16-inch MacBook Pro. I don't think you'll be gaining much portability by choosing the 14-inch MacBook Pro over the 16-inch. You're going to be carrying quite a bit of weight either way. I carry my 16-inch MacBook Pro around all the time, and I gotta tell you, that thing is hefty and it's probably not good for your back. The 14-inch MacBook Pro has the exact same connectivity options as the 16-inch model. In comparison, the M2 MacBook Air only gives you 2 USB-C ports, a MagSafe port, and a headphone jack. That might be way too limited depending on your specific needs, though you can always use USB hubs to expand its connectivity options. Now let's move on to the testing. Keep in mind, I'm not a professional tech reviewer, so the tests are not going to be super comprehensive or scientific, but they should give you an idea of what you can expect in practice when it comes to mixing and mastering tasks. First, let's compare multi-core performance with some amp sims because they're very commonly used in rock and metal mixing, and they can be very CPU heavy. The first amp sim I tested was THGO by Overloud, which is natively compatible with Apple Silicon chips. I put the amp sim on a Guitar DI track and duplicated the track as many times as possible until I got a system overload message in Logic or the audio started to crackle in Reaper and Ableton Live when I play all the tracks at the same time. In Logic Pro X, the M2 Pro chip was able to handle 308 tracks of THGO playing simultaneously, and the M1 chip could handle 388 tracks, about 23% difference. Now, what's interesting is that when I did the same test in Reaper and Ableton Live on the same computer, I got very different results. With Reaper, I was able to have 396 tracks on the M2 Pro chip and 414 tracks on the M1 Max chip. Respectively, that's 88 and 26 more tracks compared to Logic. Swapping Reaper for Ableton Live, I could put 273 tracks on the M2 Pro chip and 331 tracks on the M1 Max chip. There's certainly something going on here, and I'll show you what I discovered later in this video. The second amp sim I tested was the very popular Archetype Nolly from New York DSP. This amp sim still has no native support for Apple Silicon over 2 years after the M1 chip was first announced, so it will be run via Rosetta 2. In Logic, the M2 Pro chip could handle 30 tracks of Archetype Nolly at default setting, and the M1 Max chip could handle 36 tracks. Doing the same test in Reaper, the M2 Pro chip could handle 36 tracks and the M1 Max 38 tracks. In Ableton, the M2 Pro chip could handle 30 tracks while the M1 Max 32 tracks. You can see that archetype Nali is a whole lot more taxing on a GPU compared to TXU, and the two chips didn't show nearly as much of a gap in performance as they did in the TXU test. I'll wager that is partially due to the lack of native compatibility, but I don't know if archetype Nali as a plugin is just more CPU intensive or less optimized for the macOS right now, or both. The M1 Max chip was still able to edge out the M2 Pro chip, but not really by that much here. Once again, Reaper was able to get more CPU performance out of both chips compared to Logic and Ableton, just like the TXU test. That is very interesting indeed. The last MSIM I tested using the same method was MHUB by SCL Tones, which has native support for Apple Silicon. In Logic, the M2 Pro chip could handle 67 tracks of SCL MHUB at default setting, and the M1 Max chip could handle 82 tracks. Conducting the same test in Reaper, the M2 Pro chip could handle 92 tracks, and the M1 Max chip could handle 96 tracks. In Ableton, the M2 Pro chip could handle 66 tracks, while the M1 Max chip's 80 tracks. It's really interesting that for all three MSIMs, both chips showed the least performance difference when the DAW used for the test was Reaper. The performance differences were all around 4-5%, whereas when the tests were done in Logic or Ableton, the differences were about 19-20%. This definitely has significance, but just keep it in your mind for now, because this pattern will show again in our next test, which mimics a typical mixing into a mastering chain scenario where there are lots of tracks with different kinds of plugins and also a whole mastering chain, including a limiter on the master bus. I chose this scenario because it's very common in the metal niche and is also very demanding on the CPU. This is how the test is set up. On the master bus or stereo out of each DAW, I have SoftTube's tape plugin, Slate's FQ Red compressor, the Dangerous Box EQ, Saturn 2 with linear phase and 32 times oversampling, Submission Audio Flatline as the clipper at 16 times oversampling, and lastly, Ozone 10 Maximizer with IRC4 mode, which is the most CPU intensive mode. And I also have soft clip and transient emphasis on. This is a very typical mastering chain for me and is probably similar to yours. Basically, there's saturation, compression, EQ, clipping, and hard limiting. On each individual track, I put FabFilter Pro Q3, Slate's virtual mix rack with the classic strip loaded, SoftTube's FET compressor, FabFilter Saturn 2 with linear phase and 32 times oversampling, D16 repeater, which is a delay, and FabFilter Pro R, which is a reverb. What I'm trying to do here is to emulate a common mixing plugin chain for vocals, drums, or guitars. It usually boils down to EQ, compression, saturation, and some kind of effects. Then, I try to duplicate as many of the tracks as possible. Just like when you're mixing, you'll have many tracks with all kinds of plugins on them. In Logic, the M2 Pro chip could handle 29 tracks each with the mixing plugin chain before I got the system overload message. And in comparison, I was able to have 33 tracks with the M1 Max chip. Doing the same tests in Reaper, the M2 Pro chip could handle 39 tracks while the M1 Max 40 tracks. In Ableton, it's 26 tracks for the M2 Pro and 32 tracks for the M1 Max. Now you might wonder how much of a difference it will make without the mastering chain. I wonder about that too, so I removed all the plugins on the master bus and did the same test. In Logic, the M2 Pro chip could handle 36 tracks and the M1 Max 33 tracks, which is respectively a 21% and 19% increase in performance compared to having a mastering chain. In Reaper, however, I could only duplicate two more extra tracks for both the M2 Pro chip and the M1 Max chip, so that's barely a difference. In Ableton, I could duplicate 4 more tracks on the M2 Pro and 8 more tracks on the M1 Max. I guess the takeaway here is that plugins on the master bus affect DAW performance a lot more for Logic and Ableton compared to Reaper. Okay, so what's going on with Reaper getting more performance out of both the M2 Pro chip and the M1 Max chip compared to Logic and Ableton in every single test? Well, it seems that Reaper is somehow able to fully utilize the efficiency cores on the Apple Silicon chips, while Logic and Ableton can only utilize them at a limited capacity at best, and sometimes not at all. take a look at how the three DAWs utilize the 10 cores in the M2 Pro chip here during the first MSIM test with overloud THU. Notice how the four cores on the left were not used by either Logic or Ableton, despite running the same plugins. These are actually the four efficiency cores on the M2 Pro chip. As a result of Reaper using four more cores, Reaper was able to offer a 25% extra performance compared to Logic, and a whopping 37% compared to Ableton on the M2 Pro chip. We're talking about 88 more tracks and 123 more tracks respectively here. That's quite a lot. All three DAWs exhibited the same behavior on the M1 Max chip as well, which has two efficiency cores and eight performance cores. As you can see here, the two efficiency cores on the left were not fully utilized by either Logic or Ableton. And by making full use of two extra cores, Reaper was able to offer a 6% extra performance compared to Logic and 22% compared to Ableton. Same story on the base M2 chip, which has four efficiency cores and four performance cores. You can see that all eight cores were used to the max by Reaper. While with Logic, the four efficiency cores were just chilling. I didn't test Ableton when I had the M2 MacBook Air, but my guess is that it would not utilize the four efficiency cores either. Now, full disclosure, I'm not a computer engineer, so I don't know what's actually going on a technical level, but based on the empirical evidence so far, this is a big deal because this means that if you are a Logic or Ableton user on an M2 Pro machine, you're not getting the performance you paid for. Sure, you pay for a chip with 10 cores, you think you'll be getting 10 core performance, but in practice, if you use Logic or Ableton, you're really just getting a 6-core computer. It's even worse with the M2 chip because half of the 8 cores are efficiency cores. So really, you are just getting a 4-core chip if you use Logic or Ableton. I'm actually so curious to know why and how this happens. Is it a bug or a feature? I mean, Logic is Apple's DAW, so you would think they would make it super optimized for their own chips, like Final Cut Pro X. And it's not like the efficiency cores can't be used for audio processing tasks either, because clearly Reaper is able to take advantage of them, no problem. So if you're a computer engineer and can offer some insights on this, please leave a comment. Next, I benchmark the single core performance of the M2 Pro chip, the M2 base chip, and the M1 Max chip by putting as many instances of Saturn 2 as possible on a single stereo track. Every instance of Saturn was set to linear phase and 32 times oversampling, had 6 band, and each band had the heavy saturation mode. This made each instance very CPU intensive. The results for all three chips were completely identical. They all maxed out at 9 instances of Saturn 2 on a single track regardless of DAW used. Let's talk about RAM now. RAM is key for using sample libraries. I'll test how many gigabytes of samples can be loaded with each computer, including swap memory. In case you didn't know, swap memory happens when the system runs out of RAM and starts to borrow the hard drive space to use as temporary RAM. However, the system can't just use an infinite amount of hard drive space as temporary RAM, so we're going to find out how much memory swapping each of those three computers can handle. To test this, I created a huge drum kit in Superior Drummer 3, which contains 3.7 gigabyte of samples. On each computer, I try to load as many of this kit as possible. On the M2 Pro MacBook Pro with 16 gig of RAM, I could load 12 instances of this drum kit. 39 gig of swap memory was used, and a total of 47 gig of samples were loaded. On the M1 Max MacBook Pro with 64 gig of RAM, I could load 26 instances of the drum kit. 59 gig of swap memory was used, and a total of 103 gigabyte of samples were loaded. On the M2 MacBook Air with 8 gig of RAM, I was able to load 11 instances of the drum kit. 39 gig of swap memory was used, and a total of 41 gig of samples were loaded. The moral of the story here is that while you could use memory swapping if you occasionally need extra RAM, it's not something you should rely on, and you should just get a Mac with more RAM if you routinely use a lot of sample libraries. Next thing I tested was project loading speed on the M2 Pro chip, the M2 base chip, and the M1 Max chip. The project I used had 236 tracks and 273 plugins. To load it, it took the M2 Pro MacBook Pro 1 minute and 4 seconds, the M2 MacBook Air 1 minute and 14 seconds, and the M1 Max MacBook Pro 1 minute and 22 seconds. I guess the M1 Max chip is just slower on loading this project for some reason. The last test I did was comparing the CPU consumption of the same project on the M2 Pro chip and the M1 Max chip. As you can see here, the CPU usage is pretty much the same for both chips, which makes sense because remember, Reaper can effectively make use of efficiency cores, and both chips have 10 cores in total. The cores in the M2 Pro chip have slightly higher clock speeds than the ones in M1 Max, but I guess the difference isn't big enough to see in a real-life scenario. Now, some of you might have read that the 512GB SSD in M2 Pro computers is slower than the one in M1 Pro computers, which isn't wrong, but let me tell you right now, the slower 512GB SSD in M2 Pro computers is still really fast, and it's more than fast enough for most audio production scenarios. Like, you will not even going to remotely touch the speed limit of that SSD. The recording industry had been using 7200 RPM hard disk drives, or HDDs, for years before SSDs started to become prevalent. The 512GB SSD in M2 Pro computers has a write speed of about 3 gig per second and a read speed of 2.7 gig per second. For reference, this is the disk read when I was playing back a large mixing project with over 100 audio files. Yeah, don't worry about the SSD speed in the 512GB M2 Pro computers. Unless, I don't know, you're planning to record 500 tracks of audio at 192 kHz, I guess. I'll say though, 512GB of storage feels quite small for audio production, especially when you plan to take the laptop around a lot and don't want to take an external hard drive with you all the time. Audio recording files are big, and you can easily fill up the 512GB in no time. But if you decided to get a desktop machine, like the Mac Mini, then you can rely on external hard drives and save some money with the 512GB configuration. At this point, it goes without saying that the M2 Pro chip is going to be an absolute beast of a CPU for music production in general. I mean, all the Apple Silicon chips so far have proven to be extremely powerful and efficient. I think the more important thing to do now as a rational buyer is to have a clear understanding of what your needs are and to buy a computer with specs that give you the most return on investment, which means resisting the notion of newer is better. Don't unnecessarily overspec your Mac for the sake of future-proofing, because oftentimes we're just using that as an excuse to justify paying for extra specs we don't really need in the future. Take a look at Apple's refurbished store, eBay, or your local Facebook marketplace to see if you can find discounted Macs computers with the specs you have in mind. There are probably a lot of secondhand Macs with the M1 series chips out there. That's all for this video. Give it a like if you find it helpful and informative. Subscribe if you want more music production content, and I'll see you next time.